Thank you. Good afternoon and welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations Local Journalists Initiative webinar. Today we will discuss reporting on state distribution plans for the COVID-19 vaccine with Susan Dentzer and Carla Anne Robbins. I'm Irina Faskianis, Vice President for the National Program and Outreach here at CFR. CFR, as you know, is an independent and nonpartisan organization and think tank focusing on U.S. foreign policy. This webinar is part of CFR's Local Journalists Initiative created to help you connect the local issues you cover in your communities to global dynamics. Our programming puts you in touch with CFR resources and expertise on international issues and provides a forum for sharing best practices. So thank you all for being with us today. I want to remind everybody that today's webinar is on the record and the video and transcript will be posted on our website after the fact at cfr.org/localjournalists. We of this webinar, but I'll just give you a few highlights. Susan Dentzer is a leading expert on American healthcare and policy and frequent commentator on news outlets, including PBS and NPR. She is currently a senior policy fellow at the Duke-Margolis Center for Health Policy in Washington, D.C., and she's held roles on health affairs. Carla Anne Robbins is an adjunct senior fellow at CFR. She is faculty director of the Master of International Affairs program and clinical professor of national security studies at Baruch College's Mark School of Public and International Affairs. And previously, she was deputy editorial page editor at the New York Times and chief diplomatic correspondent at the Wall Street Journal. So Susan and Carla, thanks very much for being with us. I'm going to turn the conversation now over to you, Carla, before we open up to the group for questions.
Great. Thank you so much, Irina. And thank you, everybody, for coming here. And Susan, it is great to have you with us and happy 2 days after your birthday. You look incredibly young as ever. So I am going to start out with a big question, knowing that you will edit it for me, as you always do. So this week, the first 5.9 million doses of the coronavirus vaccine, enough to vaccinate some 3+ million people, are making their way across the country. And while we all got to watch the trucks roll and the first shots administered, I must admit that, you know, and I'm a pretty well-read person, that I'm really, you know, not sure I fully understand a lot about this, you know, how and where the decisions are going to be made about how many doses go and where they go, who gets them and in what order. And most important for this group and for us is how we as journalists can cover those decisions and assess both their equity and their effectiveness in this decision-making. I saw this list of plans. USA Today had an entire list of state-by-state plans. And I started clicking on them and I thought to myself, you know, the states, you know, each one of the states had the right to set up their own plans for the pandemic, and they didn't do a pretty good job with that patchwork. So how do we know and how do we assess how well they're going to do on this one?
Well, great question, Carla, and thanks very much for having me. It's so terrific to be here. I think what I'll do is try to share some slides now to walk through some answers to that question, that very important question. So let me go ahead and do that now. Let's see here. Now I'm going to go up here and hit slideshow. And you should be seeing some slides. Are you?
Yep.
Okay, good. Okay, so it's a very complicated area, as you said, and there is a lot of frankly good reporting on this and some erroneous reporting. I mean, just starting with the fact that actually, although there was a lot of hoo-ha about the fact that the first vaccines were being shipped last week, actually many vaccines had already been shipped to major health centers on the expectation that there would be EUA approval of the Pfizer vaccine. So Duke Health, for example, already had its Pfizer vaccine before the EUA was issued. So this is an evolving story. But it is true that with the EUA, more vaccines began to be shipped just over the weekend, as a matter of fact. Let me just basically move along here on my slides and, let me go back here. Okay. This was a feature in the New York Times a couple of weeks ago that caused a big stir. And you will note that it was couched as opinion And that was a good thing because it was open. Find your place in the vaccine line. I had a lot of friends who did this and then called me up shrieking that they were going to be 200 or 250 million people down the line. I just went in and entered my own information, and I got told that in the U.S., I was almost 120 million people down the line. In Maryland, I was a mere 2.2 million people down the line. In Montgomery County, I was 304,000 people down the line. If you didn't know a lot of the background behind this, you would have really freaked out. And the most important caveat was way, way down in this segment, where it said the order outlined above is one possibility, combining proposals by the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practice, CDC, the National Academies of Sciences. The final order is not yet determined and depends on successful vaccines being adequately tested for every group. And then states could also set their priorities, but will most likely follow the final CDC recommendations. Okay, so that was a lot of caveats that frankly contributes to why this was best couched as opinion. Of course, nobody interpreted it as opinion because it was in the New York Times. Therefore, it must be so. So what is the reality here? There are lots of factors driving vaccine distribution. And just to state the obvious ones, first of all, the availability of the vaccine, the success in clinical trials, and the success in obtaining emergency use authorization approval in the US. Now we know the Pfizer vaccine got the EUA last week. Moderna is expected to get it today or tomorrow. There's a Janssen vaccine, Johnson & Johnson. The EUA is anticipated sometime around the beginning of February. There were great expectations about an AstraZeneca vaccine. We don't know now, given a bunch of issues that have cropped up with that vaccine and those trials. We don't know when that's going to become available. So this is sort of the number one factor, is when these vaccines become available. And then, of course, how many vaccines have been produced, even to this date, because as we know, because of Operation Warp Speed and other pre-market commitments, a lot of these vaccines have been produced and a lot more will be produced. The whole issue around how many will be produced, though, is also up in the air at this point. It's dependent in part on production capacity, but also raw material supplies. And if you've been following the news, there's concern now. Pfizer has some concern that sort of the upstream components of the vaccine aren't going to be available in enough time for it to expand its production capacity as fast as it would like. So that's a kind of an unknown. Then we have the issue of the federal allocation of vaccines to the states. And of course, that is largely being handled at the federal level. It's based on population, but the federal government has not yet disclosed exactly what it is allocating to the states. It's leaving it up to the states to disclose how much they are receiving. And those amounts are going to be updated on a weekly basis as vaccines become more available. So that's another factor. And then you've got the states making decisions further on allocation and prioritization. And as that Times story referenced, a lot of the states are going to follow the ACIP recommendations, but not all. Already we've seen 7 or 8 states not follow those recommendations. So those are all important factors. And then you get down to implementation and execution on the local level. How many staff people are arrayed to provide vaccines? Where are those people? Where are the vaccination sites? It's easy, relatively easy at this point, because mostly it's healthcare workers being vaccinated, but we also have the long-term pharmacy partnership program taking off at this point to get vaccines out to people in nursing homes in particular. And there are issues with that, and a piece in the New York Times this morning flagged some of those issues that are arriving. Not the least of which is, if you've got to go back to the same nursing home on a couple of occasions, A, to give the 2 doses of the Pfizer vaccine that are required, but also because different nursing home staff are going to be there on different days, how many times do you have to go back to the same place? So all of these issues come together and bear on when people are going to get the vaccine. As we know, the CDC made an interim prioritization set of decisions about who is it most important to get the vaccine to. And this is, you can see their color-coded system of deciding what were priority populations. The ACIP at its August meeting decided that the phase one, the most important group, would be people with high-risk medical conditions, as you can see here, essential workers, healthcare personnel, and adults 65 years and older. And then, of course, it further refined that into the phase 1A population, which is just a portion of this. It doesn't include the adults 65 and older, and it doesn't include many of the essential workers. And now, in the next couple of days, ACIP will decide who's in phase 1B and what the priority should be there. And again, it's going to be this other group of essential workers, people with high-risk medical conditions, and adults 65 and older. So this very important B1B group hasn't even been fully decided yet who's going to get what. So it basically continues to underscore the fact that there's still some ambiguity and uncertainty around all this. This is the agenda for the ACIP meeting on Saturday and Sunday. And as you can see, first, they're going to take up issues around the Moderna vaccine. Again, this is predicated on the Moderna vaccine getting its EUA today or tomorrow. And then they're going to talk about phase 1B and 1C, these additional initial phases of vaccine distribution. Okay. So Carla referenced the USA Today listing of the states. We put out a report a couple of weeks ago about the state distribution of vaccines. And in this report, which you can access on our website, the URL is down there at the bottom, or you can just Google the title of this report. It has links to all of the states' available vaccination plans. And I'll point out that this list was accurate when we published it. These links will still get you to the right place, but you will see if you go to the different states, they are in the process now of updating and revising their recommendations. And various states are at different states along the way of doing that and making this information public. Also, the states aren't always following the same typology that ACIP has used. So this is an example from Massachusetts. And Massachusetts decided not to have phase 1A, 1B, 1C. They decided to go with phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. And you can see in phase 1, it's basically healthcare workers, people in long-term care facilities, et cetera, congregate care settings. That's what they're calling phase 1, even though technically some of these people are really more like 1B or 1C, and then moving on to phase 2 and phase 3. So the states are further tweaking this way of presenting to the public what order they are going to proceed in. The COVID vaccine advisory group in Connecticut is going to meet, you see, tonight. Again, this is on the expectation that that there will be an EUA approval of the Moderna vaccine today, and they will decide, well, what order they're going to have the Moderna vaccine go out in. The Moderna vaccine, many of you will know, has to be kept cold, but not as cold as the Pfizer vaccine. So it is, most states are banking on the fact that that is the vaccine most likely to go to people in long-term care facilities in the next wave of the next week, because it doesn't have to be kept quite as cold. The very cold Pfizer vaccines have to date largely been shipped to large healthcare institutions that have that very cold storage capability. So this again is a work in progress. I mentioned briefly the Pharmacy Partnership for Long-Term Care. This is the arrangement that was struck with CVS, Walgreens, and another entity called Managed Healthcare Associates, which represents some small pharmacies around the country. To deliver the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines in particular to people in long-term care facilities. Again, because this was orchestrated by the CDC, but not specifically delinked from state plans for allocation, all of these things have to go through the states as well. So I talked to the head of CVS, this effort at CVS a week or so ago, and frankly, they're kind of tearing their hair out because they're having to cope with 51 different state distribution ideas now as they undertake this program to get these vaccines out to long-term care facilities. And they really wish for greater coordination at this point and standardization, because at this point, they've just, as I say, got to strike 51 different arrangements. And the states, as I say, are at varying stages of their readiness to do this. So what this all leaves is essentially, he's blocking out his face. This was supposed to be a picture of Joe Biden with a question mark beside it. Looks like it's now in front of it. But this is now also going to fall into the lap of the incoming Biden administration in January, because we are getting some signs that they will probably try to tighten up the federal-state coordination of the additional phases of rollout of vaccines, because at this point, it has been so variable and there has been, relatively speaking, less coordination than desirable between the federal government and the states. But we will see. And in any case, what is ahead for the next few weeks is going to be a lot of movement in a lot of different directions as all of this gets sorted out. So with that, Carla, did I come close to answering your question?
You did. It was great. And you didn't even edit my question down. Thank you. That was great. So I'm sure that the group has lots of questions. I have lots of questions. So maybe we'll turn it to back to the group. And if not, I've got lots of questions. So Irina, do you want to open it up?
Great. Yes. So please raise your hand. If you click on the participants icon at the bottom of the screen, you can raise your hand there. And if you're on a tablet, you can click on the more button in the upper right hand corner and click on the raise hand button there. And please tell us who you are and your outlet to give us some context. Right now, we have no raise. Oh, no, we do. Maria Alvarez, over to you. And please unmute yourself. You should be able to go now.
I'm promoting her to panelist, as you have an older version of Zoom.
Great. Thanks, Audrey.
Okay, I'm here. Thanks. Hi, my name is Maria Alvarez. I'm based here in New York City, a freelancer for Newsday, but right now, primarily during the pandemic, I'm a professor of journalism at BMCC Community College in downtown Manhattan. And what I'm here today is because I want to look at the local aspect on how people are going to be vaccinated once this comes to the general public. And I was looking for some suggestions as to what would be the important issues that should be addressed here. Of course, equity is number one in the minority neighborhoods. My students are predominantly Black and Hispanic and of other immigrant groups. And my instinct is to have them go into their neighborhoods and talk to people who are actually getting the vaccine. But how do you visualize this happening, you know, on the ground distribution? I'm picturing it outside, not inside, I don't know.
Yeah. Some reason. Well, again, a lot of this is still unfolding because, as you can see, that for the general population, it's going to be a couple of months before it gets beyond these priority groups. So, and most states and localities are just now coming to grips with exactly how they're going to do that. Again, if you go, depending on the locality, if you go to some of these state sites, you will see that some states are a little further along in thinking about it than others. But in general, I think the basic truth is it's going to vary a lot around the country. In New York City, for example, when we think about the sort of the mass inoculation of the public, it is quite likely that the pharmacies will play a role. Again, they've been part of this long-term care partnership with the CDC. So you're going to be able to get a vaccine at CVS, for example, and at Walgreens and at Duane Reade, et cetera. It's also quite likely there will be community settings set aside to administer the vaccine, the healthcare settings, much along the lines of what's happened with COVID testing. As you know, now in Manhattan, there are walk-up places that some of the healthcare facilities are running. You can also go to make an appointment and get a test at CVS and Duane Reade and so forth. It's going to be a similar kind of dynamic that, and one imagines that there will probably be additional settings created again in public spaces, the armories, for example, or schools. But this is really still a work in progress. The other really important issue, particularly for the populations that you referenced, is going to be vaccine hesitancy. And we know that there is a lot of skepticism and concern about the vaccine in various communities, particularly Black communities, to some degree Latino communities. And we don't honestly know, even if a lot of vaccines are made pretty broadly available, which I believe they will be by certainly by March and April, how many people are going to actually want to go take it up. They don't have to. People don't have to do that. I think that the level of vaccine hesitancy is going to recede as vaccines become more normalized and as many populations get them over the next couple of months. But we honestly don't know that. So I think it'll be interesting for your students to look at both facets of that, the supply and the distribution of vaccines, and also the take up of the willingness of the population to actually get the vaccine.
Thank you. Let's go to Raul Galvin next. I don't know how. Oh, Maria, are you still, you have a follow up? Go ahead.
Hello.
Hello, Raul, go ahead.
Thank you, Rena. Susan, first of all, I would like to congratulate you on the thought that you have given to your Zoom lighting and your set. It's probably the best I have seen for a long, long time, if at all. I don't know if you're a betting woman, but I'm wondering if you had to put an estimate out on when some of these populations are going to get the vaccines. I'm calling from Milwaukee PBS in Wisconsin. So I know that they vary from state to state. But when would you say the normal people will be getting their vaccines? I spoke to Walgreens representative today, and he told me that he would see in February doing some independent living folks.
Yeah, and I well again, if you take this partnership, the long-term care partnership that was forged between Walgreens and CVS and MHA and the CDC. Depending on how you're classifying long-term care, I mean, those folks are going to start getting the vaccine next week, a lot of them, in nursing homes, for example, and assisted living facilities. So independent living is a different category from assisted living, but very often independent living places are contiguous to assisted living places. So it's possibly going to be the case that even some independent living people will get the vaccine next week if they are closely proximate to assisted living places, right? This is how kind of ambiguous all of this is at this point. So if you think about people in independent living, and I'm distinguishing this from community living, right? I mean, the rest of us live in communities. We're not in an official independent living category as you would consider a person, an older person who's in a specifically designated independent living facility. If the question is the community, when do the people in the community access the vaccine? That's going to tie back to a lot of the factors that I talked about in my first couple of slides, which is, you know, tell me that we know for sure when, for example, the Janssen vaccine, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is going to be available. And that's important because the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, first of all, is a one-dose vaccine, not a two-dose vaccine. It doesn't have to be kept as cold as either the Moderna or the Pfizer vaccines. It's going to be much more easily distributed. It's an older vaccine platform. So there's some question until we see the final clinical trial results about just how effective it is, but it looks like it's going to be fairly effective. And since it's going to be easier to administer and a lot of it has already been produced, we imagine that that's going to roll out fairly quickly. So if that does get EUA authorization in February, you could see a lot of that vaccine rolling out in February and March. This is why I think, you know, we're going to have to play this by ear and see when that becomes available. But I'm guessing a lot of Americans who don't think of themselves as necessarily being at very high risk of COVID will be able to start getting the vaccine in March and April. And then if you ask how long does it take to get it out to everybody in the country who wants it, I'm personally just taking a scientific wild ass guess now and guessing that that's June. But we'll see, because again, it ties back to all of those factors that I talked about in my slides.
Thank you. Next question goes to Katie Coyne.
Hi, my name is Katie Coyne. I am a health reporter at the Charleston Gazette Mail in Charleston, West Virginia. Our state has been, at least in my perspective, pretty proactive in putting out their plan for distribution. They have two phases split into tiers. So there's 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D, and then general population, same thing. One thing that they've put out, though, we're starting with healthcare workers. They've already gone into long-term care facilities and started vaccinations there. But when we get into the general population phase, after we get to the healthcare workers, teachers, educators, and public officials are in there, one thing that they're prioritizing is by age and pre-existing conditions. But the way that they're doing that is for the pre-existing conditions, in order to be placed in a higher tier for the vaccine than someone like me who doesn't have a pre-existing condition, you need a doctor's note, a physician's note. On its face, for a state like us, where we already historically and systemically have so many people that are disengaged from healthcare infrastructure, who don't trust doctors because they live out in hollers. We're an incredibly rural state. Some places you have to drive 2 hours to get to the closest clinic. And those places too also are home to the people that have the most pre-existing conditions and are perhaps the most vulnerable and the elderly. So I'm wondering, from your all's perspective, does that raise any flags to you in rollout there? And what could that look like moving forward with those populations?
Yeah, well, it's part of the reason that I said just a few moments ago that, you know, guessing as to when the vaccine reaches everyone who wants it in this country, it's going to be June. But you're putting on the table a couple of other important issues, which is, what about people who don't want it, or don't think they want it, or don't even know much about it, or have heard about it and are very, very leery and hesitant about it? And we know that that's the case, particularly in Black communities. How does the vaccine get out to all of those people? And as you identified, many of them are going to be in rural areas. That's the piece that it's referred to as the last mile, or sometimes the last inch of vaccine distribution. And there are very, very few states that have gotten their arms totally around the notion of that last mile, what that last mile and last inch looks like, particularly in the areas that you designated. So is it potentially a problem? Very much so. Because those populations could still be affected. And all we have to do is look at the recent surge, which has largely affected very rural areas of the country to a much greater degree than most public health people thought was going to happen. I'll give you the example of North Dakota, for instance, or South Dakota. So this is going to be a real challenge, and it will depend on a lot of factors, including the robustness of the public health outreach program in various states. And it's largely going to be public health agencies that end up getting the vaccine to those people that you described. And so I guess important questions to ask would be, what has the state appropriated for this effort, this last mile effort? Many of you will know that in the current COVID relief package that is being negotiated on Capitol Hill at the moment, there is, fill in the number, it looked like it was going to be $8 to $9 billion to the states precisely for these kinds of efforts. It's not clear what the final number is going to be, but the states have repeatedly said that if they don't get more federal assistance, they're not going to be able to undertake these last mile activities that we've just been talking about. So watch that space to see whether those dollars materialize. Watch what happens when they get to your state, in your case, South Carolina, and then watch what plans are developed to really get this to people in that last mile, last inch effort.
I'm sorry, Katie, were you also asking whether there was an equity issue here that the state was requiring proof for people who didn't have, even if they wanted it, people who didn't necessarily have easy access to that sort of, it's almost like a voter ID issue?
Yeah, so they would need a physician's note that outlines what their pre-existing condition is and how it would make them more susceptible to COVID or worse infection. And the state, to be transparent, did say they would come out with further guidelines for this when we get closer to that point. They're estimating that won't hit until probably about February, because again, it's the first phase of our general population. But yeah, my worry too is, if you don't have a physician, if you don't have a doctor, you can't get to a doctor. How do you get that note when you're still at risk in your community? Susan, but thank you. I hadn't heard last mile. So that's something I'm definitely going to keep an eye on.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, again, a lot of this is dependent. A lot of plans are being set now in a context where we don't know what the supply is going to be, right? So that's why the state is trying clearly to husband enough vaccine as possible. So it wants to make sure it's getting, while there's limited supply, it wants to get it to priority populations. I think you're going to see those kinds of things relax as more supply becomes available, right? So it's why I was saying, let's watch what happens with the Janssen vaccine. The one dose vaccine. If there's a lot of that vaccine, a lot of supply, some of these requirements I think are going to be eased a bit. So I would say watch it. You're right to identify the potential there, but let's see how it really plays out.
So is the equity issue more less the question of, being unfair in which they assign, particularly if it's an expanding pie, and more the effort to push it out, to reach into communities, to raise awareness, to go into the communities on the last mile issue? Is that your primary concern on equity issues?
It is, yeah. I mean, we don't have the infrastructure to do, I think, widespread public outreach in those areas for public health. And it's something that, we've seen this fail time and time again in West Virginia with HIV, with hepatitis. They know that these are the populations that are listed as being most at risk for these outbreaks. And there's very little proactively done to get buy-in from communities and, participate in this, get tested for hepatitis, do this. And I worry watching that over the last few years, seeing it repeat with a COVID vaccine that also has, you know, this other hesitancy on top of it too, right? The cultural aspect too.
And Susan, what do you worry about on equity issues?
You know, frankly, at the moment, the biggest equity issue that we face is the vaccine hesitancy in the Black community. And that's a legacy of the historic, you know, the Tuskegee experiment, all of the mistreatment and the health disparities, healthcare disparities, et cetera. And what I worry about is that not enough people who are highly at risk of bad outcomes from COVID, including death, will not take up the vaccine because of their fears of the vaccine. And that's a really horrible, perverse equity issue, but it's a real equity issue. I'm less concerned that people who genuinely want the vaccine and who think that they have good reason to be classified in a priority group will not get it. I think that most people will be able to get it. And again, as these vaccines become, and we think about the locations where the vaccines will be available. I mentioned obviously the commercial pharmacies. Physicians' offices will start to have them. Community health centers and federally qualified health centers will start to have them. I think as long as the supply continues to build and is broadly distributed, I do think anybody who's in a high risk group is going to get fairly timely access to the vaccine.
Thanks.
Susan, what is the percentage of the population that needs to take the vaccine in order for it to be effective?
Well, there's a lot of discussion about getting to what is known as herd immunity, which is the notion that so many people have immunity to the virus that it stops spreading as quickly as it has over the last 10 and 11 months. Most public health experts think that herd immunity is at around 70% of the population. So that would say we've got to get it. You know, we think we've already had ballpark 60 million infections in this country. Since we're a country of roughly speaking 330 million people, right? We got to go from 60 million up to about 210 million people. Again, this is ballpark, with immunity, to have herd immunity. So that means at least 150 million people have got to get vaccinated, and possibly more, because again, these are just sort of ballpark numbers. The one unknown, however, is we don't know how long immunity lasts. We don't know how long immunity lasts from natural infection. And in fact, some of the recent studies seem to suggest relatively low presence of antibodies to the virus in the body, even among people who have had active infections. So does immunity last 3 months? Does it last 6 months? Does it last longer? We don't know. We also don't know how long immunity from the vaccine will endure. Is it going to be 3 months? Is it going to be 6 months? Is it going to be a year? We don't honestly know. A lot of people think we will probably have to be giving booster shots of the vaccine. To continue just the same way, I mean, a slightly different way. We know we get annual flu vaccines. That's because the flu virus evolves, right? The SARS-CoV-2 virus is evolving and it may continue to evolve, and we may need to give booster shots for that reason. We also may just find that the immune response doesn't last as long as we thought it did. So I think it's a reasonable bet that even people who've been vaccinated once this year will end up getting vaccinated again next year or even later this year, depending on what we find out.
Thank you. So I'm going to raise two questions from the chat, and then we'll go to Amy Green, who has her hand raised. So Maria Alvarez had a follow-up comment or question about New York Governor Cuomo's comments today that no one will have to pay a penny for the vaccine here in New York. Is that realistic? And how is that? Is that going to be? It's going to be free across the country. And Stacy Josh Barton, who's at the Leader News in Central City, Kentucky, a rural weekly newspaper with 6,000 circulation, says, "What about the hesitancy in the rural community due to misinformation and political pressures?"
So I think, as many people will know, there embedded in some of the earlier COVID relief packages was the stipulation that there would be no out-of-pocket costs for COVID testing. And that has largely held true. It doesn't mean they're free. Somebody's going to pay for those tests. But individuals have not had to pay out-of-pocket tests, except in limited circumstances where screw-ups have occurred. I'll be brief and just put it under that heading. I think a similar thing is going to happen with COVID vaccines. I mean, the government has purchased all of these COVID vaccines through Operation Warp Speed. So they're bought and paid for. So most of the vaccines that are being distributed now, nobody's paying a penny for. CVS and Walgreens are getting paid by the government now to distribute these vaccines to long-term care facilities. So there's still money changing hands to support the delivery of vaccines, but it's not coming out of the pockets of individuals. So I think Governor Cuomo is absolutely right. There's not bloody likely anybody is going to pay a dime out of pocket to get any of the vaccines that are going to be available soon, because most of them have been the subject of advanced purchase agreements by the government. So they are paid for. They are paid for. Now, as to the question about, it's vaccine hesitancy in rural communities, particularly because of misinformation and disinformation. Absolutely. It's a terrible, terrible problem. There's a lot of sort of casual misinformation floating around. There's the pre-existing fear that many people have, as I mentioned earlier, you know, Blacks who know about Tuskegee get really leery at the notion of a vaccine that hasn't been on the horizon until very recently. And there's also been some concern, I think fanned largely by people who don't really understand the process, by people who worry that these vaccines got developed so quickly and have been approved so quickly, and maybe that they weren't tested as thoroughly as they ought to have been. So there's some unease about that process as well. And then finally, we have the very deliberate overt anti-vax movement that has been a feature of the landscape now for about a decade or more, starting with concerns that vaccines caused autism going back 15 years ago, and now morphing into a very deliberate, very orchestrated campaign, including funded by bad actors like Russia. There's been active disinformation and misinformation fomented on social media sites, and it's only been in the last year or so that Facebook and others have started taking down that information. So you sort of roll all that together, and people who are not that well-educated or not that sophisticated and are in rural communities and are picking up any of the little shreds of any of that, there is this sad but real vaccine hesitancy phenomenon playing out.
Amy, it looks like you lowered your hand, but I want to give you the opportunity to, great. If you want to accept, there you go. We're not hearing you, Amy.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
We can. Thank you.
Thank you. There was mention of eight states that had veered off the recommendations for plans. And I was just curious, what was there anything interesting you saw in how they had decided to differentiate from the recommendations?
Do things or not do things? Yeah. There was a write-up about this in the Kaiser Family Foundation put out a report of, I think earlier this week, noting that there were 45 states that had followed the ACIP's 1A recommendations to prioritize healthcare workers and long-term care residents. And within that group, some of the states started vaccinating those people together. I mean, not in the same room, obviously, but those groups at the same time. Some went for the long-term care people first, before the healthcare workers, believe it or not. So there was a little bit of variability there. And then there was a total of seven states that did, for example, DC and Utah put healthcare workers in phase 1A, but long-term care residents in phase 1B. So they essentially went with, we're gonna get healthcare workers first and then the long-term care folks in DC. And then Massachusetts also decided to vaccinate people who were incarcerated and people in homeless shelters in that first group. So so that was another sort of slight variability. There was a group of about 20 states that further segmented healthcare workers into very high risk healthcare workers, high risk, et cetera, et cetera. And I know that's playing out informally in other places as well. I talked to a friend of mine yesterday who's a radiation oncologist in Florida who got her vaccine yesterday. But then I talked to another friend of mine who's an anesthesiologist at Yale New Haven Hospital. And he's probably not going to get his for a couple weeks because what... And this gets down to the real arcana of all of this, but essentially there is some concern that people will have a reaction to these vaccines. One in particular is just as your immune system kicks in, people can develop fevers. They can feel a lot of soreness around the injection site. So there is some concern that some healthcare workers are going to need to take a day off the day after they get their vaccine. So Yale New Haven didn't want to be without all of its anesthesiologists. So it's not vaccinating all of them at the same time. It's doing them alphabetically on different days. So since my friend's last name begins with an S, he's not going to get his vaccine for a couple of weeks. So you're seeing that kind of additional variation play out again, as various entities along the way decide how they're going to execute on even something as simple as vaccinating quote unquote healthcare workers.
I also read that there's a variation in among states about who's an essential worker. Like Arkansas is talking about including people from their poultry industry, and Colorado was going to apparently include ski industry workers, particularly people who live in large housing units. There seems to be variability. Those don't seem to be totally wacko, though. I mean, are you seeing, I feel a certain amount of skepticism about certain states. You raised South Dakota in particular, not that I want to pick on South Dakota, but given their refusal to have masks, and when you look at the death rate right now in South Dakota, it does, shall we say, make one to begin to question the competence of the government there. Are you seeing any of the plans that make you nervous, first of all? And second of all, what numbers, what data should we be looking for? You said in particular that the federal government isn't even telling us the number of doses that they're shipping out, that we have to rely on the states for those numbers. What should we be asking our states to fess up about so that we can monitor what they're doing?
How much vaccine are you getting on a week by week basis? Because the shipments will vary week by week. You know, are you confident that you're getting, you know, an appropriate supply or not? Do you have any doubt that you're the state is somehow being disadvantaged. Now, keep in mind, overall, these are being allocated according to population. So the government's been quite straightforward about that. But, you know, what does that mean week by week, right, is going to matter, particularly if we do see production issues continue to crop up and delay more production of the Pfizer vaccine. I think that's going to be alleviated now that there's a lot of Moderna vaccine that's been produced already, about 100 million doses, right? Mm-hmm. So you've got, again, back to that first couple of slides I saw, you've got all of these different factors that are going to feed into what actually shows up in a state, right? I think that's part of the reason now there's so much uncertainty around, you know, who's in what category and when. It's because it's all predicated on, we don't have unlimited supply at the moment.
And should we be also looking at, expecting states to be clearly defining who's in what group and the speed of implementation, what percentage they've been doing each week, or what other data should we be asking for?
I think assuming that the state has put out a fully articulated plan, right, which is truly who's in what group and what is the priority, asking for the numbers. Now, an issue with that is, as we know, the states have variable levels of reporting systems here, and a lot, particularly around public health data. A lot of the public health data during the course of the whole pandemic has only come in with a lag. So I think we're almost certainly going to see lagged data coming in about vaccine reports. But if it's going to be aggregated any place at all, it's going to be at the state public health department. There are about 7 different vaccine surveillance systems that are in existence that are eventually going to get all of these data about who got a vaccine and when, partly for the purposes of continuing to monitor vaccine safety. But that data is all going to be lagged. It just is. But starting with the state and asking tough questions of the state health entities, you know, what do you know? And to some degree, the county and city. So because, for example, New York City, the public health department, is going to have probably the best handle on everything that's going on in the immediate New York City area. So, but just asking them, what data do you have? And are we achieving the allocation and distribution that you set forth? And also, how is that being affected by increasing supply? Because it will be. Things will change with more supply.
Okay. We have no further questions. So, and I know, Carla, you have many questions. We have about 5 more minutes. So if anybody wants to raise their hand, please do so. But Carla, I'm turning it back to you.
So there were adverse reactions, Susan, and more significant than just soreness or the day of chills and fever among a couple of health workers. And there has been criticism about the press coverage of this. So, and concern that this was going to lead to further vaccine hesitancy. How do we, at the same time, if there's a problem, you know, it's a responsibility of journalists to raise, you know, raise concerns about this. And it's a big country and it's, you know, and it's disparate out there. So A, what do you think of the coverage yesterday of the adverse reactions? And B, how do you think we should be covering this?
Well, it's complicated for obvious reasons. I mean, what we saw last week when the vaccine was administered in the UK, was what people would have expected, which is, you know, there's how vaccines are administered in the context of clinical trials, where the one thing you don't do in a clinical trial is say, let's put in a bunch of people who have severe allergic reactions to vaccines and test our vaccines on them, right? You don't do that. You rule out those people. You exclude them from clinical trials for good reasons. But when you move into the general population, you're inevitably going to administer it to people who will have severe allergic reactions. Now, you can screen those people out ahead of time and say, we advise you not to get this. It's why everybody knows you go get a flu vaccine, you get asked over and over again, you know, are you allergic to eggs? You know, have you had a history of adverse reactions to vaccines, right? That's important information to have. There was some criticism of the UK regulators for putting out recommendations that seemed to be, you know, very frightening to people to steer clear of this if they had any fear about an allergic reaction, as opposed to saying, no, we really want to target people who have a history of severe allergic reactions, right? So that's an ambiguity that sometimes the news media doesn't negotiate any better than some of the regulators do. The other reality, though, is, you know, lots of stuff happens every day in healthcare that people have strokes out of the blue, right? People have heart attacks out of the blue. What a lot of people are concerned about is that somebody's going to get a COVID vaccine and then have a stroke the next day, or a heart attack the next day, or 2 days later. We have to be able to say basically disentangle cause and effect, right? And say, this person did not have a stroke because of this vaccine. They had a stroke independent of the vaccine. And so how we all collectively work our way through that, I am sure we're going to see stories of people dying and somebody's going to say, well, they just had the vaccine. Just the same way we saw, well, my kid had got autism and it was diagnosed right after they got a vaccine, right? We saw that phenomenon play out. We will see it again. It's just going to be, we're all going to be beholden to step back and say, okay, let us look at the facts here and let us not try to lump everything in and assume, you know, after which, because of which, right? The fundamental error of logic. Right? It's what we're going to have to do is basically take a breath and say, we really have to study this in big populations with a lot of surveillance to understand what real safety issues are going to crop up from the vaccines.
So, I mean, maybe I'm wrong in the numbers, but Pfizer tested 30,000 people, of which half got a placebo?
Yep.
So when will we know in a big population that are including people who have a potential for severe reaction, when will we know that this is genuinely safe or safe within the notion of an acceptable notion like a flu vaccine? When will we know in the country?
I think we know a lot now that it is generally pretty safe. That's not the same thing as saying that we're 100% confident that nobody's going to have an adverse effect, right? And it's all a numbers game, because you can get really tiny effects that don't show up, manifest themselves in a huge general population for a year. I mean, this is a different modality, but some people will remember the drug Vioxx that got pulled off the market years ago. In the clinical trials, there was a tiny little signal that some people had adverse cardiac issues because of the drug. It was a little statistical signal that might be an issue. But then that drug went on the market, and it was several years before there were enough people dying of heart attacks so that it showed up in the data. And then it took another couple of years for people to say this is a big enough problem that we need to pull the drug off the market. I think that all of that dynamic will be accelerated because there's so much attention on these vaccines, and there are these seven different surveillance systems now trying to capture these data and analyze them in real time. So I think it's going to be faster. I think we'll know a whole lot more a year from now than we know today about all of the vaccines. But when would you say, you know, we're confident that these are 99.999% safe for the global population? It's going to be a couple of years.
Susan, this has been great. Thank you so much. This has really been fabulous. Thank you, everybody. Arena, back to you.
Thank you. I echo that, Susan. This has been fantastic. We really appreciate your taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us. And I hope that you will all follow Susan at Susan Dentzer on Twitter. You can follow Carla at Robbins Carla. And we will send out after this webinar the link to the recording, as well as the link to Susan's report that she shared, so that you can get to your state's data and look at the sources. As the year draws to a close, I thank you for participating in this new local journalists webinar series from CFR. Your work couldn't be more important, and we know how hard it is. Please continue to share your suggestions for future webinars by sending an email to localjournalists@cfr.org. So thank you all again, wishing you a safe and healthy holiday season.